Let's do this. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Let's ask the Holy Spirit tonight to speak to each and every one of us what His will for our lives would be. Would you join with me today? Father, we thank You for the opportunity to be here tonight, Lord. We thank You that You've kept each and every person that's in here tonight safe on these roads. Lord, I ask that You would keep them safe as they drive home for those that couldn't make it or those that are at home watching on the live stream. Father, we ask that You would speak to each and every one of us right where we're at tonight, Lord, that Your Holy Spirit would minister to us to speak Your heart, Your desire, Your will, Your purpose for each and every one of us, that we would walk out of here tonight equipped and empowered to be who You've called us to be and to do what You've called us to do as Your church. And Lord, we don't come to hear from a man. We come to hear from You. And Lord, we acknowledge tonight that it's Jesus that's the senior leader of this house. So Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that Your Holy Spirit would be our counsel, lead us and guide us and direct us in Your word as we give You the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all together said,
amen.
Amen. So I'm going to share a little bit about what we did as a team in Israel and some of the things that we did experience, some of the things that we did see. I will show you some pictures of Israel. You can't go to Israel and not bring pictures back. Although we did contrive a wonderful social experiment that I think we're going to try. And the social experiment is if you want to experience what Israel looks like geographically, not necessarily the essence of Israel, we thought a wonderful experiment would be to tell somebody they're going to go to Israel, to put them on an airplane in Los Angeles, and to give them a sleeping pill, and let the airplane fly around for a little while, and then land in the desert, Palm Springs, Joshua Tree, somewhere in that area, high desert, and then drive them around and tell them, this is Israel, and see how long it takes them to know the difference of what geographically Israel looks like. If you want to know what Israel looks like, look outside, because it is very similar to what we live, especially in the desert. There's a lot more rolling hills. It's a lot more small mountains. We have bigger mountains. But geographically, Israel is very similar to where we live in California. And as a matter of fact, one thing Mom told me as we walked or as we left, she said, you know, one thing you'll realize about Israel, about the nation of Israel, is that as far as the land goes, it's very insignificant. There's not very much to it. You would think that if this is the promised land that God chose for His people, that He would call them out of Egypt into this great and beautiful oasis of tropical gardens and you know, just a beautiful things. But He called them into a desert land, a desert region, coastal desert. The Mediterranean is beautiful, but it is a desert much like we live here today in California. But something about that land that has God's hand on it, and we're going to talk a little bit about that today. The title of tonight's little overview, called Israel's Important, because I want to talk about the importance of Israel. My journey to Israel started about 2 years ago. Stacy and I took, we took a trip on a Sunday. We took a weekend off, and we just wanted to go visit churches around Southern California, and so we went to a couple of churches in the Orange County area. We went to our friends, Bayless and Janet Conley's church in Los Alamitos, Cottonwood Christian Center, or Cottonwood Church. In the morning time. And then at night, we had a free time, and we were staying there, so we checked into our hotel, and we went to a Newport church, or in Irvine, very famous church, a world-renowned senior pastor. And we got to that church, they had an evening service, and we got to the church, and there was a line wrapped around the building. We thought, wow, this is a really cool place. Like, there is a line wrapped around the building just to get to church. And so we're standing in line. It was a really interesting, really unique experience for us, because we were standing in line, and we were kind of asking everybody, like, is this normal? And they were like, oh, no, this isn't normal. Tonight is a special night. And we said, well, what's it all about? And they said, it's a rally for Israel. And we were like, oh, cool, what is that? And they're like, well, there's this world-famous pastor who's probably one of the most outspoken Christian leaders for the nation of Israel, John Hagee. He's here tonight, and we have some people from Israel that are going to be there tonight. As a matter of fact, what was neat is as we were waiting in line, the lady we were talking to, come to find out, she used to attend The Rock. She was a Bible college graduate. I knew her. She was the girlfriend of a man that was here at the church for a long time. Just a wonderful thing. And then when he died, she moved with her family to Orange County. It was really neat. So she brought us up to the front row, and they gave us Israel flags, and everybody's waving all these Israel flags. And Stacy and I, we didn't know anything. We didn't know what we were getting ourselves into. And they start singing the Israeli national anthem. And if you know anything about Israel, they speak Hebrew in Israel. If you didn't know that, just in case they did, that the Old Testament's written in Hebrew, they also speak Hebrew in Israel because the Old Testament came from Israel, just in case you didn't know that. And so they sang the Israeli national anthem in Hebrew, and we were looking around, and people were just like worshiping, like arms raised, crying, and like, you know, like worshiping in a God. And we're kind of like, I've never had that experience with the national anthem before. Like, You know, like, you know, in the baseball stadium when they sing the Star Spangled Banner and the person's up there and we're always wondering, can you hit the high note? I've just never been like, thank you, Jesus. You know, like, and so there it was. And John Hagee was talking about the importance of Israel and everybody was waving their Israeli flags. And it was really neat. But you know what? Stacy and I, we walked away from that service and we thought, like, cool. But we really wanted to hear, it was Free Chapel, Orange County. We really wanted to hear Pastor Jensen Franklin preach. Like, that's what we came for. And we walked away from that. And to come back from Israel almost 2 years later, I say that that was the beginning of my trip to Israel because I think God had started to orchestrate some things in my heart to realize and to show me as a minister of the gospel and as a pastor of a church the importance of Israel, not just as a nation on the other side of the world, not just as a place where people of Jewish descent or of Jewish religion meet, not just a place of Jerusalem where four of the major religions across the earth, Catholicism, Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, call it one of their most holy places on earth. It's not just that. There's something more to it. And so that, I say that that really began something in my heart, a journey, so to say, of the importance of understanding the importance of Israel. And so here we are, we're at Israel, and how did we go to Israel? I'll just tell you the fun story about how we got to Israel. Miss Madeline Spuan's on the front row. She's my pastoral assistant. She's what keeps my world spinning. A couple of months ago, we had to pay $40 with a credit card to put ourselves on an interest list and apply to go on the Israel tour, the Israel trip. Once they had my $40, if you don't say no, they start charging your credit card. So all of a sudden, we got a bill for Israel, and we were like, wait a minute, how did we didn't even sign up to go. We didn't do anything, and all of a sudden, there's plane tickets in our name to Israel, and we were just trying to figure out what was going on. But God was orchestrating some things in our lives to take Stacy and I to a place at the right moment, at the right time, where we, with a group of wonderful people from The Rock and from other churches, got to experience Israel on one of the most holy days, actually their most holy day of the year, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. Now, it was a really unique experience for us as Christians to be in Jerusalem at the Western Wall where all of the synagogues go to pray and all of the believers are the Jewish believers in God go to pray and to confess and to cry out to God for their sins in a time of fasting and of solidarity. And it was a really unique experience. But I just wanted to share with you before I get into what God put on my heart. And one of the things that God impressed upon my heart, I thought I would do is I would share some of the trips of some of the pictures of the things that we went and, because Israel is truly an amazing place. Our tour was incredibly fast-paced. As a matter of fact, when I was calling my mother-in-law or my mom who was watching our kids, they were asking us, do you guys sleep? Are you sleeping? Because Israel's 10 hours ahead of time, yet we would call them when they'd wake up and we'd call them before they go to bed. Well, because our tour was so fast-paced, we get up in the morning at 5 o'clock in the morning, eat breakfast at 6, we're on the bus at 7 to go see Israel. We're back for dinner at 7 p.m., eat dinner from 7 to 8, and then from 8 o'clock to 10:30 at night, people from Messianic congregations would come and speak to us about what God is doing in the Messianic congregations, and then we'd go to our room, take a shower, go to bed at 11, get up at 5 every day of the week for 10 days. So, I mean, we slept on the plane on the way home. But while we were there, we saw some amazing things. As a matter of fact, I feel like we saw almost everything in Israel because literally it was like, go here, go here, go here. So I thought I'd show some pictures on the screens just to kind of give you a taste of some of the things that we saw. I think the very first picture is a panorama that I shot on my phone. And I wish I had better pictures, but I didn't get pictures from you guys or anybody. We have a photo share group, I think, coming up when we go to Tony and Diane's house. But these are just my pictures. So this is a panoramic of Mount Carmel. Do you guys have that yet? You're working on it? Okay. So this is a panorama of Mount Carmel. You can see it's very similar to California. It's arid, it's dry, but this is a significant mountain. This is actually our second day. We got to go worship with a Messianic congregation there on Mount Carmel, a wonderful congregation. We got to experience what a Messianic congregation of Jewish believers in Jesus, they say Yeshua, Mashiach is what they call Jesus. But this is Mount Carmel. Now, what is Mount Carmel in the Bible? Does anybody know what Mount Carmel is on the Bible? The significance of Mount Carmel? I see Donna. You can't nod, Donna. You know it now, okay? Does anybody know what Mount Carmel is? Has anybody ever heard the story of Elijah? Elijah had a showdown against King Ahab and his prophets of Baal. And they built two altars on the top right here. This is actually on the spot they believe to be. Two altars, one to the God of Baal and one to the God Almighty. And Elijah said, whichever God brings fire down is the true and living God. And so the prophets of Baal went first. They tried to cut themselves. They chanted. They tried to do everything they could. But fire could not consume their offering. Elijah soaked the offering. He soaked the altar. He did it again. And there he called fire down from heaven. And God consumed everything there on the mountain. And it was right here on this mountain where this picture was taken many thousands of years ago that Elijah called down fire from heaven. This is also a very significant place in the Bible because in the book of Revelation, the Bible talks about the end times. There's a word that you and I know in pop culture, in our own world, in our own language. We call this word Armageddon, right? They made a movie about it. There's going to be an asteroid coming or something like that, right? And they're going to try to fly onto the asteroid, right? You know, Aerosmith, remember that? Armageddon, the end of the world. This is the valley. In English, we would call it of Armageddon. This is the valley in which the Bible speaks of in the Revelation of where the final battle of the Battle of Armageddon will happen. You can see there's not many people that really want to invest in real estate in the valley of Armageddon. But right there at the bottom of the hill is where Elijah slayed the 400 prophets of Baal. It was a really neat experience to see that on the other side of Mount Carmel. You can see an overview of the Mediterranean Sea. It's so neat to see that when Elijah, right after that, he had his servant run up to the mountain and say, rain's coming, do you see it? And he came back and he says, I don't see any rain. And Elijah prayed. And he says, okay, go back and look again. And he looked over the ocean. Do you see rain? No, he didn't. So he went back and he prayed again. Look over. Do you see that? Do you see a cloud? And he came back and he said to Elijah, he said, I see a cloud over the ocean. This is the Mediterranean Sea right on the other side of this, the size of a man's hand. And then Elijah said, rain is coming. He picked up his skirt and he ran down the bottom and he outran King Ahab's chariot when the rains came and the drought ended. And so this was a really cool, significant place. And so we spent a lot of time in northern Israel, the place where Jesus spent a lot of his time. As a matter of fact, one of the really neat things that we did is we saw a lot of ruins. This is the ancient civilization of Dan. Not Pastor Dan. Dan is one of the tribes of Israel, and we got to see the ancient civilization of the city of Dan. And right here is the gates. You can see this is the ruins of the city or the civilization of Dan. And right here we had our tour gathered together, and we got to hear a little bit of the history of Dan. And where Marianne and a couple of people are sitting right here was oftentimes in the Bible you'll hear about the leaders, the kings, the judges sitting at the gates of a city to judge people as they came in or to settle discords. That was the throne or the seat in which the leaders would sit at the gates of a city and judge or determine laws, rules, and regulations right there. And so we got to see these 1,000-year-old ruins. That's the streets of the civilization of Dan. Shortly, a short way away from this area, was an area called Caesarea Philippi. Very significant to us at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. Why? Because in Caesarea Philippi, in Matthew, the 16th chapter, Jesus said some amazing words to Peter after Peter revealed that he was the Son of God. Jesus said to Peter, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. We went to Caesarea Philippi to see that. It was amazing because people have oftentimes asked us, why is it called the Rock Church? There you go, Matthew 16, 18. Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So we got to see where Jesus said those statements. It was really fun. One of the fun things that we got to do is we got to baptize or be baptized in the Jordan River. Now, for those of you who are faint of heart in Israel, the Jordan River has fish that eat your skin. Now, people pay a lot of money to go to places to do that, but the longer you sit in the river, the bigger the fish get. So I got to baptize. I don't know, do we have a picture of baptizing? So I got to baptize a group of a good portion of our group. I saw Teresa said on Instagram that many of them are, what was the word you used? Like re-dunkers or something like that. Most of everybody had already been baptized. One of the best moments I got to have in my life was I got to baptize my wife, Stacy, who's at home with our kids. That was wonderful, but she handed the camera to Bob, and Bob forgot to take a picture of her, so I don't have that, but it's okay. I love you anyways, Bob. It's okay. But we got to baptize in the Jordan River, and it was really a neat experience. You know, there was a lot of people that were really touched by just being in the areas that Jesus was in. But one of the things that was really neat was to be touched by the fish in the Jordan River, because the longer you sat in the Jordan, the bigger the fish got. So for me, standing in the Jordan River, by the time I was done, I had catfish like 20 inches long sucking on my toes. Lori, I love you. I'm so glad I got to baptize you. Don't ever forget that, all right? And same thing with you too, Ruth, all right? I had catfish sucking on my toes, but it was a wonderful experience. But it was really neat to be able to do that, to share the love of Jesus Christ, and just to be able to be a part of that. There were some really cool things that we also got to see. I'm going to have them go. If you guys, I think there's a picture labeled border. Stephen, can you throw the border one up there? One of the really neat things that we got to do while we were in the northern part of Israel is we got to go to the very northern part, to the far reaches of Israel, and this is literally on the border of Israel and Syria. And as you know, right now, there's a lot of things going on in Syria. There's a civil war taking place between the rebels and Assad. And as we were in the city of Dan, we could hear the automatic gunfire. They have howitzer cannons. The rebels have taken howitzer cannons, and they're shooting cannons across. And you can hear all this gunfire. And we thought, wow, we should probably go somewhere else. So what did we do? We went to the border instead of away from it. And this is actually on the roof of what used to be the Syrian high command, when Syria had occupation of this area in Israel, and this used to be their high command as well as an office. Now, it's had since been bombed by Syria, and when they retreated, they tried to blow it up. And now we went to the roof, and we got to pray over the borders. And I think one of the great things for me, one of the neat things for me, is that what I tried to do is, as we looked at our schedule every day, I tried to read in the Bible of places that we were going. When we would go to the Sermon on the Mount or the Mount of Beatitudes, I'd read Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And when we got to go to Capernaum, the town in which Jesus spent most of his ministry years, or most of his time doing ministry there, 18 to 24 months in the city of Capernaum, I read about all the different things he did. And one of the things I knew is that we were going to go to the borders. And I got to read some wonderful verses in the Old Testament, talking about God's restoration of Zion and bringing Israel back to a place and in their exile. And it was so neat that I didn't know that we were going to go and pray over the borders. And just right on the other side of where our guide is talking to us is a UN base, and right on the other side of that is Syria. And there's been a lot of things that have happened over the course of the years against Israel and the surrounding nations. There's a lot of animosity. There's a lot of turmoil. There's a lot of hatred. There's a lot of mixed emotions with people internationally. And it was just really neat for us as a group to go up on the building of what used to be the Syrian High Command for that region, and to pray over the borders of Israel, to pray for the peace of Israel, to pray over the people of Israel, and to pray for the support of Israel. It was a really special time for us, and it was really neat that we got to do that, and I was really glad and grateful for that, to do that. One of the neat things in the Sea of Galilee is just amazing is how small the Sea of Galilee is. When we read stories like Peter walking on the water, remember how the Bible says that the wind and the waves grew so great that he looked at those and he began to sink? Or another time when Jesus said, "Let us go to the other side," and Jesus, remember Pastor Jim was talking about this a couple of weeks ago, Jesus was asleep in the back of the boat, and the disciples said to Jesus, "Don't you care that we're going to die? The boat is sinking because of the wind and the waves." You think of this great, massive ocean, right? The Sea of Galilee is no more bigger than probably the Salton Sea across California, on the bottom of California. When Jesus said, "Let us go to the other side," literally, he could see the other side. Like, "Hey, guys, let's go there." And they would go there. Like, it wasn't this big journey. You know, how do these big waves show up on this? But one of the things that really impressed me is at night we got to see the city of Tiberias. And the city of Tiberias at night was a beautiful sight. Tiberias was founded in the time of Jesus, and ended up being the very final place of the capital of the Sanhedrin, the religious leadership of Judaism, before the fall of Jerusalem and the holdout in the Roman era. And this was a city that was just getting its start when Jesus was walking the earth. And it's an amazing thing, as I sat there at night and I looked over the Sea of Galilee and I saw the city, because in Israel, the cities and the houses are all on hills, and they are built one on top of the next, 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 and they climb the hills. And I thought that, and I thought back to the time in Matthew when Jesus talked about you and I, his followers. And he says, you know, you are like a city upon a hill, a light that cannot easily be hidden. And I've always equated that to the rim of the world, the mountains right here, and you can see some of the homes that are right there on the edge of the hill. But on a foggy day, you can't see those homes. And when I saw that across the Sea of Galilee at night, I wondered, if Jesus saw the cities that were set upon a hill like that across the Sea of Galilee as he spoke to them and saying, it's unmistakable that you can see that there's a city there. There's no denying that there's a city there. And see, Jesus said that about you when you follow him. He says, listen, when you've got me on the inside of you, you are like that city set upon a hill. There is no mistaking who and what you are to this world. He says, you are the salt of the earth. And I thought that, man, that picture just so touched me. And we got to go to some wonderful places like the Dead Sea, the lowest place on earth. Bob got to go swimming in the Dead Sea, kind of accidentally, right? But it's all right. We had a great time there at the Dead Sea. We got to see a place where they, in the 1950s, they found some scrolls that were hidden in caves that were more than 2,000 years old, and they were copies of our Old Testament. The significance of those scrolls that were found in the 1950s is that when compared to the Old Testament in which you and I read today, they were found to be 99% accurate, which means when somebody comes to you and they say, well, that Bible of yours, that's a conspiracy, and they wrote that, and all these people gathered together, you can say, look, at these guys hid these scrolls 2,000 years ago, and then they found them 2,000 years later, and the Bible that I read is the same Bible, the same Old Testament that they read then. Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words shall by no means pass away. It was so neat to see that, the validity of that. We got about 3 minutes where the Dead Sea Scrolls were at, but it was really cool to see that. One of the neat things that we got to do is when we got into the city of Jerusalem is we got to go to the Western Wall. The Western Wall oftentimes is called the Wailing Wall, and this is the Western Wall. It's very significant to the Jews and to Christians because this is all that's left of Jerusalem in Jesus's day. You see, as the Bible tells us that Jesus, before he went to the cross, he came over the hill in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he saw Jerusalem, and he wept over Jerusalem. Why? He knew, because Jesus died somewhere around 30 to 40 A.D. He knew that in a couple of years, in a couple of decades, 70 A.D., Jerusalem would be utterly destroyed because of a resistance of the Jews against the Romans. The Romans left nothing of Jerusalem in Jesus' day standing except this wall, which is where King Solomon and Herod's temple at one point used to stand. So this is the closest that most people can get to the holy place that the presence of God at one point on earth used to dwell. And so there's a very holy place to the Jews. They go and they pray there. We got to spend Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, there and praying. And it was just so neat. And that's where I believe God began to impress upon my heart today some of the things that I want to speak to you today and what God said to me about Israel. And so I'm going to put up a picture of Jerusalem, and I'm just going to talk to you for a moment, and I'll show you some other pictures. This is a panorama of Jerusalem from the garden, or from the Mount of Olives. Right below is a cemetery. I'm told it's the most expensive cemetery on earth to be buried right there. Right across the way, you'll see a little golden image. That is the Dome of the Rock. That is the second most holy place to Islam on earth. That is also exactly where the temple, Solomon's temple and Herod's temple, was built. That is the mount there. And right in that area, there's a cemetery, an Arab cemetery, and there's also what's called the Golden Gate, which we believe, or they believe, is the gate that the Messiah will return into Jerusalem. And so that's all the old city of Jerusalem, as well as the metropolitan area of Jerusalem. It's a very beautiful place to see everything made out of this wonderful, gorgeous white stone. We don't have a concept in America of antiquity. You know, every 20 years, we look at our home and we say, well, we need to tear it down and remodel it or rebuild it. And you know, there are people in the old city of Jerusalem that are living in homes that were built in the Crusade era, and yet they are still standing and they are still living in them. Thinking about your sink faucet is old. How about living in a home that was built in the 1100s? Talk about plumbing problems, huh? Today I want to just talk to you really quickly, and I'll show you some more pictures as we go through, but I just wanted to talk to you what God impressed upon my heart. And what God impressed upon my heart as I was there, after telling you about my trip to Free Chapel and John Hagee's Israel rally, is this: that Israel and the Jewish people are important to God. Israel and the Jewish people are important to God. You see, it's not just a place that we as Christians go to experience what Jesus was like, what it was like in Jesus' time. It's not just a place that we go as Christians to make a pilgrimage. It's not just a place somewhere on a map, somewhere in the world, when you open up to the back of your Bible and you see Israel and you see what it's like in the time of David and what it was like in the time of Jesus and what it's like in the times in modern days. It's not just some place on earth. You see, Israel and the people of Israel, the Jewish people, are very important to God. And so often what happens, and I say it in my own life, and that's why I included my story of that Israel rally, is that we get wrapped up in today, in the here and the now, in America. We don't hear much about what goes on. You see, every day in Israel, there's a terrorist attack. As a matter of fact, when we were in there, we were headed into Jerusalem. About three blocks from our hotel was a terrorist attack in which two people were killed and 13 other people were wounded. And we got the wonderful opportunity to go to the hospital and meet one of the police officers that was involved in that terrorist attack. His partner was the one that was killed. Junior, who's a wonderful member of our church, was also involved in our San Bernardino terrorist attack shootout. And he got to talk to that officer and just say, listen, doesn't matter where we're from, it's still hurts when we lose somebody, and from America to Israel, we support you, we love you, and we got to pray for him. It was a wonderful opportunity. But what happens is we get wrapped up in what's going on with us. We get wrapped up in our elections, we get wrapped up in our lives, we get wrapped up in our kids, we get wrapped up in our possessions, we get wrapped up in our finances, we get wrapped up in all the different things that go to take and seek to take our attention. And in my own life, We neglect to realize that Israel, beyond a country on the other side of the world, and Jewish people, beyond a people of ethnic diversity, among the people most persecuted people group on earth, are very important to God. It was so neat as I was sitting there at the Western Wall on Yom Kippur reading my Bible. I mean, how many people get to say that, right? I mean, it was awesome. As I was reading my Bible on the Western Wall on Yom Kippur, I was flipping through, just reading about the Day of Atonement, reading about various laws, trying to understand Jewish culture as I saw it and as I was looking at it. And the Lord brought me to, as I was praying and seeking after God, the Lord brought me to Deuteronomy in the 10th chapter, or the 11th chapter. In verse number 10, this is Moses is exhorting the people of Israel, and as they're about to go finally into the promised land. In Deuteronomy in the 11th chapter, verse number 10, this is what God says about this place. God says it like this. He says, "For the land that you are entering to take possession of is not like the land of Egypt from which you have come, where you sowed your seed and you irrigated it like a garden of vegetables. The land that you are going over to possess is a land of hills and valley, which drinks water from the rain of heaven. And it's a land that the Lord your God cares for." And what really impressed upon my heart as I was reading that is this next statement. It says, "The eyes of the Lord your God are always upon it, from the beginning of the year to the end of the year." You see, Israel's not just a place on earth. Israel's not just somewhere on the other side of the world, 10 hours ahead of us, time zone-wise. Israel is a place that is very important to God. It was a place that he had set aside for Abraham. He says, "Get out of the land of your fathers to a place that I will show you." And he gave Abraham a promise of this promised land. And now finally, as the children of Israel coming into it, God says to them specifically, "This is a place that is important to me, in which my eyes are always upon it." And therefore, I can understand why people would take journeys to travel all the way across the world, to risk robbery, to risk terrorism, all throughout the centuries, to go to a place in which they feel that God's eyes would be upon them as they are in the land that God is in. But let me tell you something, church. You don't need to go to Israel for God to see you, because you have the living God through Jesus Christ on the inside of you. But it does mean for you and I that this is something that we as believers, we as followers of Jesus Christ, we as believers of God Almighty must take into account, that what is important to God must be important to us. And Israel and the people of Israel are important to God. The land is a promised land, and the people are special to God's heart. One of the most special things that we got to do is we got to meet with Messianic believers. Now, they're not called Christians in Jerusalem, and we'll talk about that. They're Messianic Jews, which means these are Jews who believe in Jesus, or Yeshua is how they describe it. And it's amazing, as we got to meet with different Messianic believers, and I got some pictures. This is a wonderful man who's ministering to Russian believers. Russian Jews. Russian Jews account for 30% of all Jews in Israel are of Russian descent. And so here he's ministering to them. He has a special ministry that was targeted and aimed at Holocaust survivors. Almost every person of Jewish descent in Israel is in some way connected with family members or directly to the Holocaust in Europe. And here he has a special ministry dedicated to those who are still alive, who are victims of the Holocaust, and to Russian Jews. And we were able to hear his heart, to hear his message, to hear what he had to say about Jesus to the Jewish community. And we got to see some other believers. I think there's another picture of some other believers. These were another group of believers that were ministering to alcohol and drug abusers within Israel. Abortion, you would think in a Jewish place, a place that was created in a miracle situation by God, you would think that drugs, alcohol, and things like abortion would not be a big issue. But drugs and alcohol and abortions are massive problems within Israel. As a matter of fact, they're saying right now that there's a bigger genocide of babies happening than ever happened in the Holocaust because of abortion. There's some wonderful people standing up in Israel with the name of Jesus Christ, reaching out to the mothers who are in question about their children, who are giving them the opportunity to keep their children. It's a wonderful thing. So we got to pray with them. We got to sow seed into them and just to believe in them. And I think we have another group of people. This is on the floor there, on their knees, are praying. A wonderful group of believers, Jewish believers from Ethiopia. Jews from Ethiopia, what are you talking about? They have a special connection to Israel. What does Ethiopia have a special connection to Israel? Well, there's a story of a man in the Bible. His name is Solomon. Anybody ever heard of Solomon? Solomon had a girlfriend. Does anybody know of Solomon's? Well, he had a lot of girlfriends, actually. That was his problem. But one of the people that Solomon had an encounter with was the Queen of Sheba. And so they believe that the Queen of Sheba and Solomon had their thing, did their due, and she went back and sowed Jewish believers into, or Jews into Ethiopia. And so they came, they were called out of Ethiopia into Israel. A real miraculous story. He was learning Hebrew. God called him out of the college to learn Hebrew and says, you don't need to do that. Don't worry about it. I'll open a door of opportunity. And people started knocking on his door in the city of Jerusalem. And they started having a Bible study about Jesus Christ. And all across the nation of Israel, people are coming to him without knowing about anything else, trying to hear or wanting to hear about Jesus Christ. And so we got to meet with some wonderful Jewish believers and just to see signs, wonders, and miracles that confirm the Word of God. And I'll tell you, it's just such a wonderful thing about that. There's about 15,000 Messianic believers in Jerusalem. Now, there's 11 million Jews in Israel. And of the 11 million Jews, of them, about 15,000 are Messianic believers that believe in Jesus Christ, which means there is a vast harvest of people that need to hear the love and the story of Jesus Christ. But one thing we realized, and one thing that our eyes were open to as Americans, I remember one of the young guys, Brad, and we were sitting there in the Western Wall, and Brad says, man, don't you want to just have like a Peter moment where you get up on a soapbox and just start preaching the name of Jesus and letting them know about Jesus? And it was kind of like, man, that'd be kind of cool, but I think we'd get in trouble. As we started talking to the Messianic Jews, we began to realize that there have been some atrocious things over the centuries that have happened to Jews in the name of Jesus. Which means that Jews and Israel are very closed to the Christian community. As a matter of fact, if you think of it like this, the Russian believer, the Russian Jewish pastor there, he told us this. He said, the Nazis had crosses on their belts and on their lapels. And so when the Jews saw Christians coming with their crosses, they thought the same message of what the Nazis would bring, and they're closed off to that, which meant that the missionary effort of the Christian church within Israel is very much underground, very much quiet, and the Jews are very closed to hear the Christian message. But the beautiful thing is that the people who are reaching the Jews for Jesus are Jews, are people who are raised in the Jewish faith of Jewish descent, teaching and preaching and declaring through relationship, through acts of service, through signs and wonders and miracles, declaring the name of Jesus. And I'll tell you what, it's a slow growth revival, but there is a revival of believers, and they are a tight-knit community within the nation of Israel, and they are literally seeing miracles that you read about in the book of Acts. And I tell you, every person that we came across, every pastor that told us their story, every believer in the church told us about, well, you know what, I was here, and our guide, his dog, led him into a church in which a person witnessed to him about Jesus, and he said, show me Jesus in my Bible, and the person opened up their Bible, the other Jewish believer, she opened up her Bible and showed him Jesus in the prophecies, and he says, well, I have to believe, and people had signs and wonders, and it's like, I looked over to one person, and I said, gosh, are we saved? Like, we're not seeing things like this, but I tell you what, it's amazing that we get to support that. And here's what I want to emphasize once more today is that the Jewish people and Israel are important to God, which means they need to be important to us. And I want to take you to a section of scripture that I didn't read until I got home. And this is where God began to impress upon my heart what I wanted to share with the church tonight. And then I thought we'd conclude and just pray for Israel tonight. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Romans in the 11th chapter. Romans in the 11th chapter. Are you guys with me? All right. You okay? Some of y'all, some of you aren't. It's all good. Romans in the 11th chapter. Romans in the 11th chapter is a verse in my own life as a pastor I had not spent a lot of time in, because much like those of you who have not been to Israel, I had no connection to it, other than I'd seen movies and I'd seen things and I'd heard about things, and I went to the Museum of Tolerance in Los Angeles once when I was in school, and I saw the atrocities of the Holocaust, but I never really spent much time in Romans, the 11th chapter. But Paul the Apostle is writing to the church in Rome, mix of Gentiles and Jewish believers at the same time, and Paul writes this very amazing section of scriptures in Romans, the 11th chapter. I'm going to read it to you out of the English Standard Version. It's just a little easier to read and understand than sometimes the New King James. It's a literal word-for-word translation as well. Paul says it this in verse number one. He says, "I ask then, has God rejected his people?" Speaking of the Jews, "by no means. For I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his own people whom he foreknew. For do you not know that the scripture says of Elijah how he appeals to God about Israel? Lord, they've killed your prophets, they've demolished your altars, and I am the only one left. And they seek my life." But what was God's reply to him? "I have kept for myself 7,000 men who have now bowed the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace." And Paul begins to speak about the subject of grace. And I'm going to kind of jump, for the sake of time, to some verses down in Romans 11 chapter. Verse number 11. So he says this about the Jews. He says, "So I ask, did they stumble in order that they might fall? By no means. But rather through their trespass, the rejection of Jesus, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous." Now think about this for a moment. Our guide, who was a Jewish believer, a Hebrew believer, he said, you know, the Christian church owes a lot to the Jews. Why? Because if it had not been for the Jews, we would not know who Jesus is. And that's what Paul the Apostle is saying, is that had it not been for the people of Israel, you and I today would not be who we are, where we are, with Christianity, with knowing who and about Jesus Christ. We have a great debt to the people and to the nation of Israel. Why? Because it is them who brought us Jesus Christ. And it is Jesus Christ. Remember this above all else. When we think about Israel and the Jewish people important to God, remember this above all else. Jesus Christ was a Jew. Circumcised on the eighth day, just like the customs and the traditions, raised bar mitzvahs at 13. He was a Jew. We owe a lot to Israel and to the people of Israel. Now listen to this, though. I really think what Paul is so eloquent, what he says in verse number 12. He says, now listen, if their trespass, if their stumbling, if their rejection means riches for the world, and their failure means riches for the Gentiles, look at what he says, how much more will their full inclusion mean? Think about that for a moment. If because they rejected Jesus Christ as Messiah and the dispersia happened and they were spread around the world and Jerusalem was destroyed and life as they knew it ended, but because of that we know Jesus, how much more of a reward is it for them when they are included into the body of Christ once again? There is a great inheritance for the people of God. And he goes on and he says, now I'm speaking to you Gentiles, to you and I, that's us, the outsiders, the non-Jewish people. Inasmuch as I'm apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry, verse number 14, in order somehow to make my fellow Jews jealous and thus save some. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? If the dough offered as first fruits is holy, so is the rest of the bread, the whole lump. And listen to this. He says, and if the root is holy, so are the branches of the tree. And then he gives this picture about you and I. He says, but if some of the branches, speaking of the Jews, were broken off of the tree, and now you and me, although a wild olive shoot or a wild olive branch, were grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing of the root of the olive tree, don't be arrogant towards the branches. If you are, remember, it is not you who support the root, but it is the root who supports you. Think about that for a moment. When we say that Israel and the Jewish people are important to God, Paul says, listen, he gives this picture. He says, like an olive tree, that my people are an olive tree. And some of them rejected me, so I cut the branches off, like John says in the 15th chapter, that whom God loves, he will prune, and some of the branches will be cut. If there's no fruit, they'll be cut, and they'll be removed. And he says, but remember this, as you are grafted, if you are placed into that olive tree, that it is not you that support the tree, but it is the tree that supports you. It is imperative for us, the Church of Jesus Christ, Christian believers, to support, to back, to stand behind, to believe in, and to pray for the Jewish people of Israel, the people around the world of Jewish descent, and for the nation of Israel. Why? Because it is not us that nourishes the tree, but rather it is the tree, the debt that we owe to the Jewish people, the people of God, the sons and daughters of Jacob, of Isaac, of Abraham, who now brought us Jesus Christ. We owe to them the debt of our lives because of Jesus Christ. And I love the restoration of what Paul says. He says it like this. He says, and if even they, if they continue in their, if they do not continue in their unbelief, will be grafted in, for God has the power to graft them in again. For if you're cut from what is by nature a wild tree and grafted contrary to nature, he says, into a cultivated olive tree, how much more will these, the natural branches, be grafted back into their own tree? You see, the Jewish people are very important to God. And this didn't really settle into me until our last day, the last place that we went. We went to the Mount of Olives, that where this picture was taken, and we went to the Garden of Gethsemane, the place where Jesus Christ prayed before he was betrayed by Judas and went to the cross. And there in the Garden of Gethsemane are olive trees that are more than 2,000 years old. Which means, if Barbara Hughes is listening ever before this, those could have been the same olive trees that Jesus Christ prayed in. Because Barbara was having a connection to everything with Jesus. And this is a picture of the Garden of Gethsemane. And right behind me there is a 2,000-year-old olive tree. This is the place where Jesus prayed before he was betrayed. And it was really neat. It was really amazing. And I thought, wow, that's cool. Those are really old trees. Cool. Move on. And so we went into this really neat church, and when we came out, our guide told us about olive trees, and I'm going to show you a close-up of these trees. That is a 2,000-year-old tree trunk, but those branches coming out are not 2,000 years old. You see, the way an olive tree works is it's not difficult to graft a branch from another tree into an olive tree. Simply put, all you have to do to take something from one olive tree to another olive tree is cut a branch off and stick it into a hole in the olive tree. And that tree, if it was dead, will come back to life because of the root or the branch bringing nourishment to the root. All of a sudden will activate the tree once again, and the tree from the roots up will begin to spring up a new life and give life to the branches that were grafted in, and the tree will begin to grow again. As a matter of fact, we were taught when it comes to olive trees, he said this, because it's a very hot topic. He says if they were to drop a nuclear bomb on Jerusalem, which there are countries, don't be mistaken, there are countries around the world that want to do just that. That, he says, within a year, olive trees would start springing out of the ground once again. Why? Because there's something about them. And Paul paints this picture. He says, listen, the trunk might be dead, it might seem lifeless, but you and I are grafts of an olive tree that was on the outside looking in, that God cut a branch off and he stuck it into the trunk, and we began to breathe life into the tree. But guess what happened? The tree began to nourish the branches, and the branches begin to grow, and they begin to flourish, and the tree came alive again. You see, there are theologies across the world called replacement theologies where people actually believe, and this is the premise of the Holocaust, that the Jews had their chance and they missed out. And now it's time for the Christian church to have their chance. But let me tell you something. The Jews are not done. God is not done with the people of Israel. God is not done with his Jewish believers, his descendants of Jacob, Isaac, and Abraham. God is not done. As a matter of fact, in Revelation, the 7th chapter, God gives us specific directions that it's the children of Jacob that have an inheritance in the end time harvest, which means God is not done with Israel. And what is important to God better be important to us. And so therefore, church, if there's anything we get beyond connection to crusades, beyond old buildings and rubble and things of places where Jesus might have walked, might have died, might have been laid into a tomb or not, nobody really knows except God. The thing that is important for you and I to understand is that Israel and the people of Israel are important to God. And therefore, it is our job to stand for who and for what, or for what, and I should say, and for who God loves and cares about. We have got to stand up for who and what God loves. You see, Israel's a miracle. Israel shouldn't exist. We got to see the remnants of the Six-Day War. We got to see the remnants of the Yom Kippur Wars. We got to hear the stories from a guide who was in the army at the time of these amazing battles and these amazing times of how Israel became a nation. It should not exist when four Arab nations surrounding it in one day all decided to push Israel into the sea and wipe them from the face of the earth. Yet in 6 days, they came back victorious with more land than they had before. It is a very important place for you and I to be behind. You see, Israel, behind North Korea, you may not have known this, is the most hated country on earth. And the Jews, the Jewish people of Jewish descent, are the number one hate crime ethnic group on earth. Well, we've seen it. From the time that God called the Jewish people to be His chosen people, they have seen hatred, they have seen wars, they have seen battle, they have seen violence, they have seen bloodshed. Not just a generation ago, we saw 6 million Jews in Europe exterminated because of the hatred. Why does the world hate the Jews so much? So simply this, the Bible tells us that the devil is the prince of the power of the air, the god of this age. That he was handed dominion of this earth by humanity. God hates what, or the devil hates what God loves. And God loves His people. Therefore, from now until the end, when He is cast into the lake of fire, He will do everything He can to obliterate those who are chosen and called by God, including you and me, but especially God's chosen people. But they are instrumental in the return of Jesus Christ, and so we need to take that seriously today. So what we need to do is we need to stand for who and for what God loves. I'm going to say it like this. David said in Psalms 122, he said this, he said, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Church, what can we do? We're on the other side of the world. Sending money to Israel, if we don't send it to the people that we have relationship with, will go right into the Jewish people at large, and very little of it will go to messianic believers. Israel will not allow you to go in and proselytize or preach the gospel of Jesus Christ because they want Jews to stay Jews. They don't want you try to converting Jews to Christians. Israel was built to be a Jewish nation. So what can we do to support and to stand for what God loves? To pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Simply that, to pray for Jerusalem. To pray for Israel, to pray for God's people. We met this wonderful man who was involved in politics in Israel, and he said these. He said, it is so important for you as Christians to pray for Israel. At any given time, every day of the year, there's a terrorist attack in Israel. More than 1,000, they don't tell us this, more than 1,000 rockets a year are fired into Israel from the bordering countries. And you see, you and I, as the believers of Jesus Christ, as fellow branches in the olive tree of God, must get behind and support. And if anything we do, we can start by praying for the people of God, for the land of God, because His eyes are upon that land from beginning of the year to the end of the year. Israel is surrounded by violence. Jerusalem is engulfed in violence. Like I told you about, there was a terrorist attack the day of us traveling into Jerusalem. As a matter of fact, we went to this wonderful place called the Zion Gate. Right outside of this gate is the tomb of David. This is the Zion Gate. Now, if you look at the Zion Gate, it's all dimpled up. It's all mashed apart. Why? That's the result of the 1967 Six-Day War. Jerusalem was occupied by Jordan, and they took back Jerusalem. And those are bullet holes from the wars that have come on Israel's soil. And so we have got to continually pray and believe for the protection of Israel, for the peace of Jerusalem, for the people of God, the Jewish people, to see their eyes open to Yeshua, the Messiah, so that they would see signs, wonders, and miracles. You and I need to get behind the messianic believers, the tight-knit group of peoples, and pray for them, that God would protect them, that God would lead them, that God would direct them, that God would use them and utilize them to restore the people of Israel to accept and to see Jesus Christ as their Messiah, that they would be restored and grafted in to the holy olive tree once again. You see, we cannot afford to not be behind Israel. Why is that? Because it goes all the way back to God's promise with Abraham in Genesis, the 12th chapter. God told Abraham this. God said, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. You see, church, Israel can't just be a country on the other side of the world. It can't just be a place that someday I'd like to go. That's great, and we'll have tours, the church. We will facilitate opportunities for those of you who want to see Israel. We will facilitate places and times for you to go see it. We will, okay? I promise you that. But it can't just be a place on the other side of the world that once had Jesus. Israel and the Jewish people are important to God. And God's own covenant to his son, Abraham, his friend, the father of Judaism, the father of Christianity, the father of all that we believe in our faith. God says to Abraham, those who bless you and your people, I will bless. But those who curse you and your people, I will curse. Church, we cannot afford to not support Israel. What can we do? Well, first and foremost, what we can do is we can pray. We can pray for the nation of Israel. We can pray for the Jews around the world that are facing immense persecution even today. You know what you can do? As American citizens, you have congressmen, you have senators, you can support things that support Israel. Let me tell you something. If you know me, I am not a political person. They tell you the two things you should not talk about in public are religion and politics. I've made it my life's work to talk about one of them already, so I'm trying to stay away from the other one. But let me tell you this. Deals with countries like Iran and Saudi Arabia and other countries that are surrounding them, whose sole mission is to remove Israel from the face of the earth, are not in benefit to the country and to the nation and to the people of Israel, which means you and I as American citizens can have a voice. We can write to our congressmen, we can call their office, and we can say, I want you to represent me in supporting Israel as a nation. Listen, right now Israel's under attack. Just a couple of weeks ago, Vladimir Putin said that he will back the Palestinian state that wants to take most of Israel's territory to create a state and take it away from the Jewish people. You and I, more than ever, need to stand behind the nation of Israel and get behind it. Why? Because what is important to God must be important to us. And Israel is important. Paul says, remember, church, remember, olive branches, it's not you that support the tree. You were brought into the tree. It's the tree that supports you. And it is so important for us to stand behind the people of God and trust that God has a plan and he's not done with them yet. To love our Jewish brothers and sisters and the people of Israel. Today, would you join with me and let's pray for Israel. Can we do that today? Father, we come before you, Lord, and we lift up right now the nation of Israel. Lord, we know that your hand is miraculously upon that land. Father, we know that your eyes are on that place 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, from beginning to eternity. God, we know your eyes are there. Lord, we ask that you would help us as a church to develop relationships with messianic believers, that we might help to influence the spread of Jesus Christ to those, that they might come to see who you are and your son, Jesus Christ, who he is to them. Father, we ask that you would protect that nation right now. 70% of Israel's annual budget goes to defense because they are surrounded on all sides by nations that hate them. But Lord, we know, like you promised to Abraham, that you would bless those who bless him and you would curse those who curse him. So Father, we ask right now that you would bring peace to Jerusalem, because we know that nothing can happen until peace comes to Jerusalem. Lord, we ask that you would set your hand upon the Jewish people around the world, Lord, that they would come to know who Jesus Christ is. And Father, we thank you that you would set upon our hearts a burden to pray for your people, to pray for your land, to see what is important to you as important to us. And God, we commit to pray and to keep in our hearts the nation of Israel as something that we would continually pray for and believe and do everything we can to support as we can here in America. And Lord, we give you the praise and the honor. We thank you for those that have gone before us, Lord, that those who tripped and stumbled, that we might know Jesus Christ, Father. We thank you that they would be grafted in, Lord, that their families, that their legacy. God, we thank you that you have a plan, and we don't know what it is. It's a little vague. It's a little gray to us. But Lord, we know that the Jewish people are important to you. And Lord, we pray for them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen? Amen. Amen. Well, we had a great time. Thanks for putting up with me telling you a little bit about Israel. It's very important. Listen, before we leave today, I want to take just a quick moment. Those of you who are in this place today, you may not know who Jesus is, just like there are many people around the world who do not know who Jesus is. Today, I want to give you the opportunity to introduce you to the man, Jesus Christ, who came, who walked this earth, who died on a cross for your sin, for your shame, for my sin, for my shame, that I might know God deeply, that I might be connected and reunited to God. So often what happens is we think that if we sit in a church, if we go to a church service, if we give ourselves a title of religion, that everything between us and God is good. But let me tell you something, the Bible is very clear that it's not about your position in a church service. It's not about the title that you've given yourself. It's not about a cross or a crucifix or a Star of David that you wear around your neck. The Bible tells us Jesus Christ said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And he says no one goes to the Father except through him. And today I want to give you the opportunity to meet Jesus Christ. If you've been living your life empty and void, trying to figure out what the meaning of your life is, maybe you've been chasing after a title, maybe you've been chasing after position, maybe you've been trying to fill relationships with your life to find a meaning in your life, but yet no matter what you do, there's like a thirst that you can't seem to fill. Listen, the Bible tells us that Jesus is the one who came to bring us life and that we would have life more abundantly. And abundant life is not about amount of things that we have, but it's about being filled with God and the presence of God in our lives and in our hearts. And God came, sent his son Jesus Christ to die on a cross so that we could be reunited to him, connected to him, that we could be in a relationship with him. God is not interested in a sense of religion. He's not in a sense of a pious belief system that might have an outward action of good. God wants your heart. He wants your life. As a matter of fact, Jesus says to his church, to his believers in the book of Revelation, he says these words. He says, behold, I stand at the door, and he says, I knock. And he says, whoever opens that door, he says, I will come in. And I will dine with them, and I will be with them, and they will be with me. You see, there's an invitation, I believe, right now on your heart from Jesus Christ, from the Holy Spirit, knocking on your door. Will you open the door to Jesus Christ? Maybe you've been searching. Maybe you've been wondering. Maybe you've been seeking after an answer in your life. And today, I want to tell you, you have a divine appointment tonight to know Jesus Christ and to know God Almighty like you've never known him before. To find peace in your life, to find fulfillment in your life, to find purpose in your life, and that all comes through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. It's not about your mental assent or your carnal knowledge of who Jesus is. I can say it like this. I know who the President of the United States is. I know his first name. I know his last name. I know the address of the house that he lives in. I know his wife's name. I even know his dog's name. But that doesn't mean that I know him personally. You can know all about God. You can know all about Jesus, but miss the personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And today, I want to give you that opportunity. Here's what I'm going to do in just a moment. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go like this. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count of three, I'm going to go three. I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. When I do, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying, Pastor Luke, what you're talking about today, that's me. I feel like I just need to do something. I need to give my heart. I need to give my life to Jesus. I feel like as you're speaking, I feel like God is knocking on my heart saying there's something that I need to do in my life. And here's what we're going to do together. We're going to pray a prayer of salvation. I'm going to pray a prayer of salvation. And what you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're just saying, you know what? I want to be included in that prayer today. What you're talking about is talking to me. I feel like there's something going on in my life that I need to respond to. If that's you in this place, in just a moment, I'm going to clap my hands together. And that's you. You pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. See, Jesus said these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. He says, but if you deny him, he will deny you. Listen, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He won't force his way or make his way. And so often people think, well, if God really wants me, he'll just come and take me. God wanted you so much that he sent his only begotten son to live on this earth, to be tempted and to live life like you and I live, and then to go to a cross innocent of sin and to die so that we could be reconnected to God. He did everything for you, and in return, he wants a wholehearted relationship with him, and it starts today by making that commitment. We'll pray a prayer of salvation. Simply doing what you're doing today is you're saying, you know what, that's me. I want to pray a prayer of salvation today. All across this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, listen, if you're here watching on the closed circuit television outside or at home on the live stream, you can join along in the prayers. We pray together. Wherever you're at, if that's you in this place today, the Spirit of God's knocking on your heart today. If that's you, I want to encourage you to make the very best decision you could. Who should raise your hands if you've never given your heart to Jesus, if you've never given your life to Jesus? Today, get ready in just a moment. If you're not sure, listen, the Bible tells us that it is not God's purpose, it is not God's design for us to walk around life hoping, wishing, wanting that we might get to heaven or we might be right with God. I spoke to a young man one time. He says, man, I hope I'm right with God. Do you know the Bible tells us that God's Holy Spirit comes upon you when you accept Jesus Christ as his seal of approval in you? You've got the Spirit of God when you have Jesus in your life. You've got the Spirit of God living on the inside of you, which means there is no question of your position with God. So if you're questioning that position today, in just a moment, you raise your hand. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. We'll pray together right after that. If you've been living lukewarm, the Bible talks about lukewarm relationships. In the book of Revelation, Jesus says, if you are lukewarm, he says, I will vomit you, reject you out of my kingdom, out of my mouth. Lukewarm simply means that you got a little bit of relationship, a little bit up, a little bit down, a little bit in, a little bit out. Occasional church attendance, token prayer, doing your own thing, doing some of God's thing. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. If that's you today, I want to give you the opportunity to accept and to receive Jesus into your heart, to find purpose in life today. We'll pray that prayer of salvation together in just a moment. If that's you, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and go forward together from there. All across this auditorium, wherever you're at, this is your moment. This is your time. You're here tonight for this very reason. Don't reject, don't stop, don't close the invitation of Jesus Christ on your life. I'm going to count to three. If that's you, all across this auditorium, if that's you, you just pop your hand up real quick. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm here to build you. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put your hand right back down, and we'll pray together from there. You ready? Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands in this place today. If that's you, you want to give your heart, you want to give your life to Jesus. I see you, my man. Anybody else in this place today say, man, I wonder if I should. Yep, you should. That's you in this place. You want to give your heart, you want to give your life to Jesus Christ. You scratch your head, I'll count you. Anybody else in this place? One wise person. Hey, I didn't embarrass him. I won't embarrass you. Anybody else in this place today? One wise person. One wise person. Anybody else? Well, hey, you know what? Wait, Lionel, it's pointing. Ushers are pointing. Ushers are pointing. Hey, I got you. I got you, man. Look at you. Good job. Anybody else? Two. Where are you at, number three? Where are you at, number four? Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. Is God knocking on your heart? Is it time to respond to that prayer of Jesus Christ? We're going to pray a prayer of salvation together right here, right now. Anybody else today? I don't want to miss you. Two wise people. Well, praise God for two. I'll take it. Amen. That's great. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. If you raise your hand, or maybe you should have raised your hand. I told you we're going to pray. I want to pray with you personally. So I'm going to invite you, and in a moment, we're all going to stand. As we stand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, purse, your Bible, your umbrella, friend, if you need a friend, whatever you brought with you. Get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come meet me right here at this altar today. We're going to pray together, you and I. And then you're going to accept and receive Jesus Christ into your heart and your life. So I'm going to ask you, if you raise your hand, maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you should have. You said, man, that was me. I feel like I missed out. I want you to just get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come meet me right here at this altar. Let's change destinies together. Let's all stand. Please, nobody leave. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come meet me right here. Let's change destinies together right here, right now. Right on, buddy. Good job. Hang out right here. We'll just pray together, okay? Just right here real quick. If that's you, come on. You come. They're still coming. If you need to give your heart to Jesus, this is your time to respond to the invitation. Right on, my man. Give me a hand. Give me a handshake. Hey, listen, guys, I got to tell you something. Jesus tells this awesome story. He talks about this shepherd who has 100 sheep. And he says, if a shepherd has 100 sheep and one of those sheep goes out into the wilderness and gets lost, he says, what is that shepherd going to do? He's going to leave the 99 good ones and he's going to go after the one. And he says, will he not rejoice more for the one that was lost that is found than the 99 that were always good? The Bible tells us that heaven, Jesus says that heaven is rejoicing for the decision that you guys are making today. Good job. We're going to pray together. The Bible says that if you confess, profess, proclaim with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe with your heart that he died and rose again, that you will be saved. So we're going to pray a prayer together. I'm going to say a couple of words. I'm going to ask you just to repeat them after me. I'm going to ask everybody here tonight to repeat them after me. If you're at home watching on the live stream and that's you tonight, you can also repeat these words wherever you're at. Let's pray together. Listen, God doesn't listen to the words of your heart like an abracadabra magical prayer. He listens to the prayers of your heart, all right? Not the words of your mouth, the prayers of your heart. So as you pray these things, you believe them. And I believe God's going to come into your heart. He's going to come into your life. He's going to make a change. That's going to be so great in your life. Let's all bow our heads, close our eyes, and let's go before the Lord together. And everybody in this place, repeat this prayer after me. Father God, I come before you today, and I acknowledge that I need you. Today I commit my life to Jesus Christ. I repent of my old ways, of my sins, and today I commit to follow after Jesus as the leader, the Lord and Savior of my life. I believe that he came. I believe that he's real. I believe that he died on a cross for my sins. And today, I dedicate my life to him. Come and fill me with your Holy Spirit. Wash me clean of my past and direct me in my future. I'm saved, headed for heaven, leaving hell behind. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Congratulations, guys. Hey, listen, really quickly. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel. He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to give you some free information. We want you to leave hooked up with some stuff, okay? He's going to introduce you to come back. We're going to get you connected with a friend that'll pray with you, that will invest some time in you here at church to get you strong in the ways of God. So if you guys would just go to your left, my right, with Pastor Joel. Amen.